I do. I want to get back to the audience questions, but you know, okay. Ash vs. Evil Dead. We had what appears to be the series finale not too long ago. Both of you want to get your thoughts on that finale? And I mean, look, I'm going to cut to the chase. Like, is there any more from this universe that we could ever hope to see, or in other incarnations, or just talk a little bit about the ending of Ash vs. Evil Dead?
We're sad.
I am a little sad. We knew going into the third season that there was a chance that the ratings had been trending down. It's hard to change that. Stars, who had been a good partner over Spartacus and in picking up Ash and pretty much letting us do anything we wanted, it was probably just not the right outlet for it, but they waited until the ratings came in the third season and said, no, it's just not working for them. It did incredibly well when they sold the rights for the first two seasons to Netflix, but they won't let a competitor have something, which I kind of understand. It's a bit unfortunate, but yeah, we felt that through the third season of Ash vs. Evil Dead, the series kind of landed where it wanted to go, and we had a really great idea of where it was going to go in the future, and it was something Sam had been talking about in rebooting a movie, what that scenario could be. And then Bruce wrote to Sam and I one day, right as we were getting close to that, and said, if they don't do it, I'm retiring from Ash. But wait. I'm like, Bruce, what about a movie? No, I'm retiring. So, we'll see. You can't run a blade up and down a half mile of drive to get all of the
he needs us.
Yeah, he'll get tired of that. So, but no, I know Sam and myself have been talking about what a new incarnation would be.
Xena.
Xena. I'm going to tell you about Xena.
Okay, tell us about it.
No, look, I'm the wrong person to be at the helm of doing Xena. So there's been a bunch of attempts to get it made. Well, writers coming in, Universal at that time.
Well, tell them why you said that. You feel that you...
I feel like we told a lot of really good stories, and that we captured lightning in a bottle with Xena.
Yes, you did.
With Lucy and with Renee, and then with the cast that was built around it, many have gone on and had very fine careers on their own. And you? Going back to try and capture that lightning, so when we would get a script for the reboot, I'd feel like, oh, well, we did that, we did it a little better, or maybe this. So it just never reached the next potential. And I think if somebody said we want to do a movie, but for whatever reason, and maybe that'll change in the future. And then I've always had a problem when I look across the group of actresses out there going, well, who would I want to replace as Xena, as Lucy Lawless? And I just, it's a tough one. Yeah, so like I said, I'd be happy to write for
you.
Somebody will have a new take on it one day, and
Dana.
Maybe soon, and they'll do it.
Well, Lucy, were you happy with, one more Ash vs. Evil Dead question? I mean, Ruby was such a good character, and such a great character to go toe-to-toe with Bruce's Ash. Were you, how'd you feel about sort of her send-off?
I loved it. I don't mind that. I'm like, awesome, if I'm going to go out, I'm going to go out in a rooster tail of gore. It's going to be famous. I'm not very sentimental about when one thing ends, another adventure starts. And as I told you before, I'm ready to do something super, super pared down and honest. That's my intention. I hope it works out. But however, that show was not done. There was an awesome new direction to go in. It bought in Brandy, what's Ariel's last name? Excuse me, right this moment. Anyway, Ariel was a teenager
Ash's daughter.
That was going to go a whole new, cool, pathway. So it might, I'm throwing it out there, we can all throw it out there a little bit, the stars will go, you know what, we see the error of our own ways. Let's get that going again. And I think Bruce will just have to follow on.
All right. Well, let's take another audience question right up here. Hi there, how are you?
So, what do you think the importance of female fantasy characters and racial minority fantasy characters are on adolescent development, especially the rise of Wonder Woman and Black Panther? What do you think this kind of phenomena is, and what does it mean to adolescents in particular?
I can say from my experiences that people love to see, everybody needs to see themselves ripped on screen. Everybody. The lesbian community went, we love Xena and Gabrielle. It's because they saw something in themselves just for once to be ripped on screen. So if there is a redress in the balance towards equality of minorities, I mean, yeah, we need to see some Asian superheroes, more black heroes. I mean, we're in arrears, right? We're in arrears. I think it's very important for people to see themselves reflected in the media in a positive way.
And I'm going to tell a story out of school because Sam Raimi and myself and another gentleman, Sam Hamm, right after the riots in Los Angeles in the 90s, realized that something needed to change and that there was people were not seeing themselves on screen, and we came up with and sold to Fox at that time a 2-hour movie that was the basis for Hopefully to Go to series. We got a certain ratings, and we created a show called Mantis, a black superhero show, and it had 5 black leads and 2 white leads, and Fox and Universal kind of fought us about that, but eventually we shot the pilot, and we really liked it, and it was a 2-hour movie. They didn't like it and weren't going to promote it, so I hired a guy to come in our office at 1 o'clock in the morning to start to call the drive time hip hop radio stations on the East Coast for morning drive time and kind of working across to the West Coast. And eventually that 2-hour movie went on, did great ratings, the highest ratings ever for Fox, and they had to order a series. So the first thing they did is try to change it to 5 white leads and 2 black leads. And we went up to the head of the studio's office and said, this is a really bad idea. And he said, no, we're going to do it. And one of the people of the cadre I was with said, look, that's such a bad idea. I wouldn't piss up your ass if your guts were on fire. It took us 5 minutes. I'm sorry. So we walked back to our little bungalow on the lot, and by the time I got there, my lawyer was on the phone saying, they're just going to replace you guys off the show. You're off.
Bye.
And we were all replaced off of it, which was unfortunate. They went and did a season, and the show was a disaster. And a great actor, Carl Lumley, I don't know if you know who he is, was kind of left hanging out to dry in the lead in that series, which was unfortunate. But so the executive branch has finally changed their mind about that.
Yeah.
And that's really the difference of today and 20 years ago. The money people see the difference.
And there are kids in the room,
and they just
learned a really interesting new expression. So you're welcome, you kids in the room, and parents that have to explain it to them. Lucy, would you see that applying to a future iteration of Xena? Like, would you be excited to see like a person of color in the role, in the lead role?
Yeah, I've often said that I think it was for it to be a black woman superhero, that would be cool, don't you think?
Absolutely.
But we always, Bob always cast, like Bobby Hosea was one of Xena's lovers, and Tony Todd, you've always been casting widely and for a
few of those roles.
Has always made sure that our shows were peopled with people of all color.
Yeah.
If you look at them, you can see it on screen.
Well, guys, we only have time for two more questions. I picked the game. Hi, how are you?
Hi, good. Hi, John. I'm just wondering, what was it like being pregnant while filming Xena and doing the funny stories?
Wasn't that conducive to horse riding and coming back from having had my baby? And the first day I show up, I wanted to jump off a box into the sand up and shove a fight. And I felt like my womb was going to fall out of the sand. And I was like, it was just a really horrible first day back. I don't recommend it. But for everything else, we have a prime minister in New Zealand and she's pregnant at the moment. And oh, the furore, how dare she use her body for the because she's a young woman, she's in those years. How dare she get pregnant and be a powerful woman? It is the epitome of power is to create life, and it doesn't mean that you're not, you know, you don't do this for intelligence. Woo!
Great prime minister too,
based
on like social media,
and
she's got some charisma.
Oh, no, and she's super intelligent, so
yeah.
A lot of integrity, I'm really young.
Yeah.
I know her role, she's brilliant.
Okay, final question. Hi, how are you?
No pressure whatsoever. Hi.
No pressure.
So great to meet you, thanks for coming to Michigan. Of course, I'm most attached to Xena. One, because you know, it's great to see a woman kicking ass. And also, Sam Raimi and Bruce Campbell went to my high school. So I have that, yeah, we went to...
Gross.
Yeah. Yay! feels like forever ago. But anyway, what I want to ask you is, like, you've had such a diverse career, you've done so many things. What I wanted to know was, what do you consider to be your greatest achievement?
In my career?
In your career.
Oh, definitely Xena. That was I'm not built for sport, I'm not gifted in any way and any of that stuff, and it was really mind-blowing matter to get through that job, so that was, I'm proud of that, and I'm especially proud of the effect that it had on out there in the community. Though it wasn't just my work, it was a lot of people who brought that to you, but on behalf of all of us from Xena Success and
thank you,
Elizabeth. We say thank you very much for making our careers meaningful.
Yeah. Thank you. So on that note, Detroit, of course you guys are awesome. Lucy's heading back to our table. She's going to be hanging out there for a little bit, correct?
Yes, I'm hanging out for a little bit.
So go see her there. Detroit.